Good morning. Praise God for bringing us to the third and the final day of this three-day conference of missionaries of Indian Evangelical Mission. In another few days, we would be getting back to our field situation, sometimes back to routine and humdrum that drives us mad. But I believe that what we have gathered and received during these 3 days in the presence of God, in the fellowship of His servants and His saints, I'm sure will take us a long way. I want to really thank God for giving me this privilege of bringing God's word to you on these three morning sessions as Bible studies or whatever. I would like to really take this as a unique privilege that has come into my life ever since I began my ministerial life with missions. This is the first time I ever have joined a body of this nature of Indian Evangelical Mission. Even though in person I have interacted with several staff and workers and leaders and partners and supporters of Indian Evangelical Mission over the years, this has been the first time that I was given this opportunity. And I very much felt at home. I felt as if I was addressing the missionaries of Blessing Youth Mission. So I want to really thank God for your love and your affection and your hospitality. And above all, your naturalness. That's what is very much missing in many Christian circles these days. But I appreciate the naturalness that I see in your expressions, in your relationships, and in your response, everything. And that, I believe, is very Christ-like. And I see a very bright future and hope if you continue to maintain that non-synthetic naturalness in your Christian life and in your Christian ministry. Because that's what we really need. We must be supernatural, but we should be naturally supernatural and supernaturally natural. So I believe that this morning, as we come together again with God's Word, we have before us some of the very important truths that we should constantly bear in mind when we go on to build the kingdom for God. When we turn to the two epistles of Timothy, we have not been able to cover the whole lot during these three Bible readings, but I believe that you will definitely take time, either during the vacation that follows or when you get back to your field or office, go through all the 10 chapters of these two epistles of Paul to Timothy afresh, and you will see many truths will come alive, and you will see the Lord taking you into new heights and new depths and new widths and breadths of understanding and appreciation of His love and His plan and His purpose in your life and that of others who are working with you. On the first day, we emphasize that phrase, "But you, O man of God," you can't do it. So you have to make some difficult choices. So we studied 12 tensions that we normally, servants of God, we come across. And yesterday, we just went through the passages where there are references to Satan, his snares, his traps, his temptations and ultimate destruction and perdition and so on and so forth. So we built a message around that particular thought that runs through these 10 chapters as the lies that we should not believe as missionaries, lies of the devil. I told you at the beginning of yesterday's message that nothing paralyzes a missionary like believing the lies of the devil. We should learn to disbelieve them. And only when we believe the truth of God rather than the lie of the devil, we will be set free. We will find an inner release within ourselves so we can function to our fullest capacity and potential. And we will see our gifting opening up into new areas and avenues. Now we will conclude this series of studies this morning looking at the aspect, one particular aspect of God's people or God's servants as soldiers in God's kingdom or soldiers in God's army. Now I'd like to take you through some passages. First of all, I'll begin with 2 Timothy, 2nd chapter, and look at verses 3 to 6. 2nd chapter of 2nd epistle, verses 3 to 6. "You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of his life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And also, if anyone competes in athletics, He is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. The hard-working farmer must be first to partake of the cross. So here the apostle is explaining the servant of the Lord with a background of three metaphors. First, a soldier we have in verse 3 and 4, and then a sportsman in verse 5, and then a sawyer in verse 6. Soldier, sportsman, and sawyer. Now we would like to look at the first metaphor, namely soldier. You find in these 10 chapters there are at least 7 references to being a soldier or waging a warfare or working for the kingdom. So there are references to this reign, rule, fight, kingdom, soldier. Let's quickly go through them to make a layer course as a base for our study this morning. First epistle, first chapter, and verse 17. Now to the King Eternal, a doxology or a worship that usually comes at the end of an epistle. Here Paul gets it at the very first chapter because he was very excited. Now to the King Eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. King. Look at verse 18. This charge I commit to you. The word charge is not normally used in the civilian life. It is a military language. It's a military word. This charge I commit to you, that by these things you may wage a good warfare. Underline that word warfare and also the word charge. And 6th chapter, look at the 15th verse. Who will manifest in his own time, he who is the blessed and only potentate, sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. The King of kings and the Lord of lords. The kingship, the sovereignty, the only potentate. And come with me to the 4th chapter of the 2nd epistle. And verse 1, I charge you therefore. It's more than commissioning. We all have commissioned officers. The word that is very frequently used in the military life is, I commission you. And then if you want to give something specific as an order, you say, I charge you. It's not because of the despise or the dislike that you have for the person who stands before you, who receives orders and commands, but this is something from which you cannot escape. You cannot evade that. It has got no exception. You have to accept it. You have to abide by it. So I charge you therefore. And he speaks about his appearing and his kingdom. Look at the language. It's a very royal language if you take all these streams and then run through these 2 epistles. And then the 4th chapter again and the 7th verse. I have fought the good fight. The soldier fight. And 4th chapter, 8th verse speaks about the medal that is laid for me, the crown, the crown. The judge here does not speak about one who would say which is right and which is wrong, who is guilty and who is acquitted, not like that, but the one who would distribute rewards, who will decide. You know, we have judges for sports, so that's what he has got in mind here. So here we find 7 references to the kingship of the Lord Jesus Christ and the warfare of God's people. Now I want to this morning speak to you about this battling aspect of God's work. The first time the Lord Jesus Christ made a statement about the church, I don't know whether you have ever noticed it. The first time that word, that beautiful word, that glorious word church came out of the lips of the Lord Jesus Christ, you know what he said? I will build my church, no full stop, comma or semicolon. Then he says, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. In other words, in God's work, building and battling always go together. Now this is the truth that we should understand at the very beginning and outset, lest we get discouraged. We should not be taken by a surprise when there is battling. Without battling, there is no building. It is literally working again. We are on the offense. The church is on the offense to go and bang the gates of hell, and the devil is not able to hold them. He is on the defense and we are on the offense. Now that's what happened pictorially in the ministry of Nehemiah, which we very often use in the mission context. On one hand he had the trowel, and the other hand he had the sword. So building and battling always go together. Indian evangelical mission, as I would look at it, as any other mission in this country, is an army of dedicated men and women who are engaged in an intense frontline warfare or battle. Let us understand that. I don't want to send you from here with rosy promises. No. I want you to rough it out. I want you to really be prepared as you go from here. Some of you, when you get back to your situations, you are going to see things which are much, much more difficult than what you have seen in all the years past of your Christian ministry in your mission field. But I want to tell you, if you understand the message proper this morning, you will be able to handle it. You will be able to conquer it. And not just conquering it, you will come out more than a conqueror. Victory plus. In order that we may not be discouraged and distressed in our Christian ministry, which is nothing but a warfare along with our work, I felt necessary this morning to redefine before you our basics in the army of the Lord, so our strategies may be strengthened. And I thought about at least 10 of our basics in the army of God. And I'll try to give a pictorial representation in my message so you would never ever forget what I'm explaining to you this morning. Imagine that we are all just going as a missionary team with a typical, traditional, trademark missionary shoulder bag. You know, that is what we are normally known. It has now come to be known. We have that bag made in Karigiri near Vellore and we call it missionary bag. Now, I don't think that you should have that picture, but now, with your shoes on and your breastplate and your belt, everything on, and with a sword on your hand, you march on. I believe that picture of a soldier who goes to war, as is usually given in the songbooks of French missionary parade band from the time of Brother Emil Jebusing, I think that's more meaningful. That's a better picture of a missionary, not with a badge. So we go with that sword on our hand and march forward. And if you had carefully watched that particular diagram, you'll see the face and the chin of that soldier lifted up. I was an under officer in the NCC when I was in the college. And when I inspect this troop, that's the first thing I do. There will be people who will be just slouched like this. And the first thing I will do is just hold that chin and lift it up a little bit. That's the first thing that you need to do as soldiers, as men who go into their warfare. So let us do it. So I want to present before you these 10 basics, and I believe the Lord will really encourage you during this session. May the Lord really enable us to receive the ministry that I'm bringing to you in the power of His Spirit this morning. The first basic that we should constantly remember, who our commander is. Our commander is Christ. It may look very simple. It may look like a kindergarten lesson, but this is where we need to begin. Our commander, not just Lord. You know, sometimes we get so used to some of the religious terms, they lose their meaning. That's why we say Lord, Lord, but we never do what He bids us to do. That was the case with the disciples also. It just becomes a word of address. It means nothing to us. So that's why deliberately I have chosen that word, our commander, our field marshal, is the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to tell you, beloved, if at all you want to see any success in your ministry, any fruitfulness in your ministry whatsoever, your life must be characterized by obedience, simple, implicit, immediate obedience to the Lordship of the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no other way. Let me put it bluntly. Obedience should be personal as well as corporate. As a team, it should be a corporate obedience. And as an individual, it should be a personal obedience. If individuals don't walk in personal obedience to God, there cannot be any expression of corporate obedience. Obedience is more than service or sacrifice. Sometimes when we backslide in our lives, we increase our service. We even increase our sacrifices. But to obey is better. That's why the Lord Jesus Christ, when he met with a group of people who were too busy with their activities of prophesying, preaching and evangelizing, etc., etc., and when they said, "Lord, Lord," he said, "Not everyone who says, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven." And he concluded that great sermon on the mount about a man who obeyed God's word and built his building, who stood all storms and all fled. It is possible, friends, to be involved in the work of God for our own job satisfaction. It is possible. When you get into that trap, you are no more aligned in God's perfect will. Get job satisfaction. I want to do it because I just feel good. I have my own ego satisfied. My ego needs are met. Not that I'm walking in fresh obedience to God. To what extent we submit ourselves to God, to that extent only we can exercise authority on Satan. That is another truth we should never ever forget. That's what that military officer said when he came and stood in attention before the Lord Jesus Christ. And when Jesus said, "I'll come home and heal your servant," he said, "Not necessary. I am under authority. I tell someone to come, he comes. I say go, he goes. I say do this, he does it. Under authority, I exercise authority. Now you are under the authority of your heavenly Father. Speak the word only, my servant will be healed." That Satan will obey. And Jesus said, "I have not seen such a faith, not even in Israel." So while we go to release people from the captivity and the bondage of Satan, we need to exercise authority. We need to not just share a beautiful story of the Lord Jesus Christ from Nazareth or Bethlehem, but we need to preach the word with authority. To that extent, you submit to the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. Only to that extent, God will back your word and he will confirm it with signs following. He who obeys God and fears God will fear no man. He will be bold like a lion. That's what the Bible says. The righteous man. We read in Proverbs 28:1, "A righteous man shall be bold like a lion." If you allow me to paraphrase the statement for the context of this morning message, I would say that a man who obeys God and fears him will not fear man. But if there is a shake up and let up in your walk of obedience and submission to God, you are giving a foothold for Satan. Take for example anger. Be angry, sin not, give no place to the devil. All together you should read. You know, sometimes because we have got verse numbers and chapter numbers, we think that they all speak about different things. No, it's a continuous thought. Be angry, sin not, give place to the devil. Don't give place to the devil. What does it mean? If you let up a little bit in your life, you are giving a foothold to Satan. And again, James says, submit to God and resist the devil, he'll flee from you. But in our song we say, resist the devil, he'll flee from you, resist the devil, he'll flee. He doesn't flee from us, he follows us. But the Bible says, submit to God and resist the devil. So that is the condition. It is submission to God to give you the power and authority to resist the devil to the extent that you run away. Otherwise, you may be seven in your team, and all the seven of you may be sons of pastors. Like the seven sons of Sceva, you will lose your t-shirt, and the devil will get seven t-shirts. You lose everything, you have to run away. You may be seven, big number, mighty number, perfect number, but nothing will happen. Because the devil can easily identify pseudo-disciples. Mission leaders cannot identify pseudo-missionaries and pseudo-disciples, but the devil can easily identify and discern who a pseudo-missionary and a pseudo-disciple is. May the Lord give us grace to walk in obedience. Implicit, absolute, unquestioning, and if necessary, blind obedience to our commander, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The second thing I would like you to remember and redefine as our basic in the army of the Lord is our flag. It's our flag. It's a flag that goes in the front. Any troop or any battalion is known or identified by the flag that goes before, not the faces of people. You can't identify faces of soldiers when they are in uniform, but it's the flag that matters. And our flag is love. Our commander is Christ, and our flag is love. We are very familiar with that beautiful text in Book of Song of Solomon, chapter 2 and verse 4, where we read, the flag over us, or his banner over us, is his love. Friends, why is it there is suffocation in most of our mission stations? Why is it most of the missionaries go through times of depression? Depression is due to suffocation. Suffocation is due to absence of the breath of love of the Spirit. Let's restore it back to our mission stations and mission fields. The secret of Pentecost was oneness. The secret of post-Pentecostal miracles was oneness. People spend too much time in Acts 2, but very little time in Acts 3. But I like Acts 3 more than I like Acts 2. Because Acts 3:1 gives me the greatest miracle ever. I believe in Acts 2:4. When I was filled with the Holy Spirit, I started speaking in tongues in 1962, and I daily speak in tongues. But that is not a great miracle. But what I read in Acts 3:1, that is a great miracle. You know what that miracle is? Now, at the hour of prayer, Peter and John. That's a miracle. So far, Peter was operating separate, John was operating separate. And both of them diametrically opposite temperament. One was the son of thunder, other was a man of slumber. Both of them, they came together. So they came together. And when they saw a man, earlier they had seen that man, not 1 year, 2 years, 40 years. Where was he? In that beautiful gate. It was a beautiful gate, but it was an awful sight. And what did these two men of God say? Look at us. They did not say, look at me. So far they will say, look at me. But now they started to say, look at us. Not look at you, yes, mind you. So look at us. So when they said, look at us, there was a great miracle. There was a great miracle. That was the greatest of all miracles. Friends, you in your mission fields, I want to tell you. This I can speak with tears and a heart that bleeds. Because the greatest problem we have in our Blessing Youth mission, without apology, I'm just expressing to you, is interpersonal relationship problems. At what level? Not at the grassroots level only. Not at the level of our average missionaries, not just at the level of our station in church. At every level we have interpersonal relationship problems. We find it easier to love God whom we have not seen, but we find it difficult to love man whom we have seen. Because God is very abstract. We can tell a lie, Lord, I love you, and we don't need to love him. Because nobody knows. We can see 100 songs about our love for God. I still remember A.W. Tozer in one of his books, he said, Christians never speak lies, they simply sing them. So we can just keep on saying. But the problem is that we are not able to love someone who has seen. Relationship problem. What was the main prayer of Jesus? What was the main thrust of Jesus in his high priestly prayer? That they may be one, as we are one. Look at the heart cry and the longing of our eternal Savior. So he really came with expectation when he descended from heaven that he could import that heavenly oneness on this earthly scene. How much he failed. How much he was a disappointed, rather. That would be a better theological word. And what was the plea of the apostles? If there is any mercy, if there is any kindness, if there is any bowels, beloved, please be of the same heart, be of the same mind. On the basis of the high priestly prayer of Jesus and the plea of the apostles and the New Testament epistles, as a servant of God with the word of God before me in the presence of the Spirit of God, I bow my hands before you, dear friends, and plead with you, dear missionaries. Learn to bury your differences and embrace your fellow workers, and you will see miracles happening. I assure you, I guarantee miracles to you when Peter's and John's come together. Divided we fall, only united we stand. Unfortunately, we think that unity is uniformity. No, thank God for the interdenominational stand of Indian Evangelical Mission. Thank God for people of diversity, diverse background, different denominational persuasion.
We could still come together. I had the privilege of working in CNC hospital when Jayaprakash Narayanan was admitted for a serious disease for a couple of weeks. And we used to visit him in that main ward, and then we used to talk to him and all that. And one of the things that he was highly sounding to his fellow party men during that time, I still remember. You know what he said? Oh, ideologically we are all from different parties. We are all poles apart. Doesn't matter. But we have a common enemy. That is Mrs. Indira Gandhi. That is the only thing that is common. That is the common denominator for all of us. So let us bury our differences, come together, finish her, then sort out our differences. They did finish her. We know that. Now, I think that is a real message that the Church of Jesus Christ needs to learn. We all have differences. We have hundreds and hundreds of differences. And I tell you, brothers and sisters, this is time to come together, bury our differences, finish the job, and once we finish the job, God in His mercy will not leave us on earth any longer. So He will take us home, and when we go up there, we have lots and lots of time to discuss our differences. Because the eternity also we need to be doing something, you see. So go on discussing your differences there. But this is not the time. Time is too short. The strategy, the warfare is too intense. We can't afford to be playing around. We are Christians by our love. Love one another. Then the world shall know that you are my disciples, not like the birds that we wear. The stickers that we stick on our car. We simply put at the back of our car, praise the Lord, and the fellow who comes behind us will be wondering, which Lord? And sometimes we say that I will never leave you. One day I was just saying that one fellow had put that sticker, I will never leave you. I thought, poor fellow, will never leave me. You know, we have lots of meaningless stuff. And we think that's the way to show that we are Christians. No! Our birds and our banner of love. Love one another. Not because that we think alike, in spite of we think alike. The third thing that I would like to emphasize this morning, friends, I want to assure you that I am speaking with a burden and a concern from what I have seen firsthand and experienced myself in missions. Thirdly, the basic that we need to redefine is our music. Our music should be worship. Each military army will have a military band and they have an anthem. Our music should be worship. I would urge you to read the 2 Chronicles 20th chapter when you find time. A beautiful passage of worship. You know the truth that I really find it fascinating all the time? King Jehoshaphat, he was standing before God and he opened up his hand and he said, Lord, this is a huge army. I won't be able to stand before them. We are too little. And God encouraged him with a prophetic word. And that man, you know what he did? He placed and he lined up worshippers before warriors. He put singers before soldiers. Have you put worship before your work? A question. Have you put worship before your work? I'm not saying whether you sing one or two songs every morning when you gather together. I'm something more than that. Are you taken up by worship as much as you are taken up by work? The Father seeks worshippers before He recruits workers. Let us understand that. And I have found in all my life that worshippers make good workers. Let me say that again.
true worshippers make good workers, I have invariably found.
Most of our mission situations can be compared to the walls of Jericho.
Walls of Jericho cannot be broken by banging with bulldozers,
but with praises unto God.
Shouts of praise, which looks absolutely ridiculous and meaningless to the world. Coming around the city 7 times on the 7th day? Ridiculous.
But that's what God's prescription is. Increased praise, increased worship. Now, everything I really enjoyed here in this 3 days program, every bit of it I enjoyed. But I still believe that you in Indian Evangelical Mission should grow deeper and more in the area of worship. You should get addicted to worship. If it is worship time, I want to go. If it's worship, I want to sing and praise. And you know, that's something you should never grow weary and tired of. And I want to tell you, that will bring in fresh life into the ministerial strength and stamina of this great mission which God has raised in our country. Take this as a prophetic word. And I urge all leaders, whether you are a state leader or an area leader or a regional leader, and I want to urge you to give yourself to worship, 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 and see that the spirit of worship permeates into all sections, whether it is office or it is works for, everywhere. Because after all, missionary work is to find a worship group in every village and every people group, isn't it? That's why we go. Unless we are worshippers, unless we are expert worshippers, we won't be able to raise worshippers. Let us really understand it. There are sometimes some very good articles are coming in Mission Frontiers about worship and warfare, worship and witness. Give yourself to the study of these things. There is no substitute for worship. Don't substitute work for worship. We need to really praise God all the time. I'm so happy whenever I come across that particular text. How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good tidings and shout aloud on the mountains. Again worship. Your God reigns. Worship, praise, anthem, raise. The fourth emphasis that we need to maintain and the basic that we need to redefine in our army march. Thank God for the theme song. I don't know whoever composed it. It's so beautiful. The theme song. March on, march on, march on. The fourth basic, our discipline. An army is known for discipline. Our discipline is holiness. Our discipline is holiness, integrity, honesty, and sincerity are becoming rare commodities in Christian ministries. Hypocrisy, humbug, and corruption are becoming commonplace. What are these wounds in your hand? Asked the man, and the wounded man answered, these are wounds that I received in the house of my friends. Christ is wounded in the house of his friends, because holiness is lost and it has evaporated.
Why should we have holiness written up? It shall be upon every pot in Jerusalem.
That is domestic life.
Holiness unto the Lord shall be written on every bowl in the altar.
That is religious life.
Holiness unto the Lord will be written on the belt of the horses. That is the ministerial life or the work life or the warfare. You see, domestic life, every pot. Religious life, every bowl on the altar.
Outdoor work, belts of the horses. What shall be written? Holiness unto the Lord. No area that can be excluded.
Where did you receive your missionary call? I saw a shout. I heard shouts. Holy! 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 And I heard a voice saying, whom shall I send? Friends, I want to tell you, it is in that context of holy, 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 I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? Missionary work cannot be separated from an atmosphere of holiness, because it is there we receive our missionary call and commission. The devil can counterfeit a miracle, but he cannot duplicate a holy life. That's the only thing he can do. All our godmen in our country can sometimes perform greater miracles than what we witness on the platforms of our healing miracle crusade. But they cannot duplicate or reproduce holy life. An old saint said, maybe it was Robert Murray McChain, I don't remember. He said, a holy man is an awful weapon in the hands of God. You see, a holy man is an awful weapon, awful instrument in the hands of God. Friends, without holiness, we shall be like rifles without bullets or swords with blunt edges. Back to holiness. Let holiness become our watchword. Accountability to one another in our work spot. Take time for self-examination. Once in a way, at least once a month, take one full day. This is my personal counsel. This is my personal counsel. And you'll see the difference if you go through this exercise. At least one full day a month. Cut off yourself from all other activities, even holy activities, ministerial activities. And take a sheet of paper which gives you some self-examination questions. Get lost in one jungle, in one forest, in one garden. Kneel down before God and go through that list and come under the cleansing stream of Emmanuel's blood and see the difference. Come out again. You'll feel so refreshed and recouped and renewed to face new challenges and demands of your ministry. And I prepared a questionnaire for missionaries. I'm sure that is made available. It can be distributed today before you leave from here, and keep it in your Bibles. I prepared that questionnaire with the missionaries in mind. It's a self-examination questionnaire for missionaries. The fifth basic that we would like to emphasize or redefine, our supply, you know, supplies are very important for army. Our supply is God. Our supply is God. As the ministry grows, our financial needs are multiplied. This is inevitable. We are grateful to the thousands and thousands of Christian folks all across this nation and elsewhere for their liberal, sacrificial contributions and offerings. But remember, all of you remember, both who are in the office and in the field, and those who are in the front line, and those who are promotional workers, please listen to me now. Listen to this statement. But all our contributors are only channels, but the source is God. You should never forget it. It should not be just an empty confession, but that should be in reality. It should be there at every fiber of our being, especially those in the top leadership who are responsible for the financial inflow and also financial management and control. God is the source. People are simply channels. Looking above to God for every need, small or great, is fundamental in God's work. My help comes from the hills. My help comes from God. Thank God for budgeting. Thank God for our promotional methods and whatever tactics we use. As long as they are sanctified and scripturally okay, it's fine.
But where do we keep our eyes upon?
Apostle Paul rightly wrote to the Philippian believers, "My God shall supply your needs." The emphasis there is, "My God." You know, a God with whom I have personally worked all these years, who have never left me, disappointed me, deserted me, "My God shall supply all your needs." That "my" is important. That God who is so personally concerned about our needs and our longings.
If we don't look to God for our financial needs, we will get into all sorts of unscriptural methods and tactics in fundraising. We will learn the Philistine and the Egyptian and the Babylonian method of fundraising. I want to say another word here. Praise God, your budgeting and the inflow of money into Indian Evangelical Mission has been so healthy. I just made an inquiry about that. Now, we in Blessing with Mission, in all these 32 years, we never ever once went without what we wanted. We always had a surplus all the 32 years, and the payment to the missionaries were never delayed by one day. It is always at the beginning of a month and not at the end. Everything okay. But I have repeatedly told our workers, just because God is taking care of all our financial needs, that doesn't mean God's stamp of approval is there on all that we do. Blessings are good, but they are not direct, conclusive indicators of God's hand. Some of the richest people in the world are ungodly people. And some of the richest people in the world are atheists. So we should never forget that. So far God has not led you into a very dry spell. But if God in His wisdom would like to send you through a dry season or a drought period, be ready for it. If we have a van, we will drive. If we don't have a van or diesel, we will walk. Amen? I am mentally preparing you for any eventuality, because such days are not too far. God purposely may send dry seasons into our ministries. It is at that time we will be tested whether our faith all these years has been on God or on our promotional mechanism. The sixth basic that we need to redefine this morning is about our weapon. Our weapon. Everybody knows it is the Bible. There are six weapons listed in Ephesians 6th chapter, which we call the spiritual warfare passage. And some people call it seven weapons because they include the prayer aspect also with it, praying always. Let us say that all the seven put together, there is only one weapon that is offensive. That is the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. The enemy will have no gainsaying when there is a scripture. If you are the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. It is written. Finish. If you are the Son of God, do this. It is written. You know, after one or two such experiences, the devil, you know, he is usually counterfeit. So he will say, it is written, when you jump down, and most of us stop there because we know what is written, but most of us do not know what is also written. Jesus knew what is also written. So he said, it is also written. And there was no other argument for them. He stopped there. And the Bible, you know, very beautifully says, the devil left him. Go for a season. I am interested in that word left. Because it's too much for him. Because straight shot. It is written. It is written. It is also written. He just left for a season. Because he also must have some healing time. For a season. Friends, what is the place you have given to the word of God in your life. Several of you studied the Bible, spent more time with the Bible before you became missionaries than after. But do you know it is after you became missionaries you are supposed to spend more time? Because now you are in the battle. Is now you are in the battle, friends? Saturate yourself with the scriptures. Every missionary I would very strongly prescribe and recommend, meditate and memorize at least one scripture verse every day. Take this as a home assignment for the rest of your ministerial career in Indian evangelical mission. One verse every day, memorize it. Don't say, brother, this you should have said 20 years ago when I was young. Now I have grown old, I am not able to remember things. Shall I tell you? Old people remember better than young people. Young people, boys and girls, when they fight with each other, they fight and kick, and next evening they come and again play together. But old people, you speak one word, they never forget it for life. So our memory power is strong. Our memory power is far superior to the memory power of youngsters. So use that memory power to memorize scripture verse. One verse a day. One verse a day. Do that. Most of the days I do it. That's how I'm able to bring out God's word from my mommy filled my reservoir first and then I started filling it. Jesus did not say, oh, the devil has come, come on, that fellow from that attendant of the high priest, you please bring the scroll from Isaiah, I want to see where is written what, or the book of Deuteronomy. No. Jesus spoke from the heart. He spoke from what he meditated and memorized during those 12 years to 30 years, perhaps, or even much earlier. Read the word of God. Meditate on the word of God. Study the word of God. Eat the word of God. Become strong. Because you are not in Tamil Nadu all the time to attending 365 special evening meetings every year. You are in places of spiritual dryness, sometimes darkness. And you don't listen to lots of big messages, inspirational talks. But the word of God will feed you. Every morning when you open up your Bible with an open heart, under the open umbrella of the Holy Spirit, heaven will open up for you to shower the fresh manna upon you. Believe it, beloved. I'm encouraging you this morning. You don't need to feel dry anytime. Brother, I don't have fellowship there, but here is God's word. In the land of pilgrimage, in the earth of pilgrimage, your songs had been, your scriptures have been my songs, said the psalmist. Build all your ministry on biblical principles. It's not how much you do, but how you do that is important. In your anxiety and enthusiasm to produce results and show to your section leaders or area coordinators, don't adopt Philistine methods. Be stuck with biblical methods. Biblical methods are never outdated. Because my Bible says, heaven and earth shall change, but the word of God shall never ever change. They have eternal principles for earthly ministry. The seventh basic that we need to redefine in our army is our strength. What is our strength? The Holy Spirit. Our strength is Holy Spirit. Is there someone who can stand up without opening the Bible and shout aloud Acts 1:8? Anyone? Acts 1:8. Stand up and shout aloud. Stand up and shout aloud. Okay, very good, brother. Please sit on Acts 1:8. Anybody in English? Stand up. Shall we all read that verse together? If you don't know it by heart, I mean, I think it is an unforgivable sin as far as I am concerned. I don't know about you. So you just open up your Bibles. Acts 1:8. We all will say it aloud. You shall receive power, everybody. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, in all Judea, in Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. This is a very important verse in the mission context. You know why? These are the last recorded words of Jesus Christ on earth. Acts 1:9 says, when Jesus spoke these words,
he was taken up. A crowd took him out of their sight. These are the words of the dearly beloved Lord Jesus Christ, the last recorded saying of my Lord and my Savior and my Master. They are very important. And Jesus would not let them go until they were endued with power from on high. I want to tell you, brothers and sisters, the Holy Spirit is not a subject of discussion, but he is a person for reception. You will not be successful in your missionary work if you are not anointed with the power of the Holy Spirit. Then your next question, brother, how will I know whether I am anointed with the Holy Spirit or not? I will tell you. If you are anointed with the power of the Holy Spirit, you will know it. That is the proof. Until and unless you know that you are anointed with the Holy Spirit, keep asking, it shall be given. Keep seeking, you shall find. Keep knocking, it shall be opened unto you. If you then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Ask for it. Wait before him. I am not fighting with you whether you have the Holy Spirit or not. I am talking about the anointing of the Holy Spirit on your life. How will you know? If you have got it, you will know it. Let not somebody tell you whether you have got it or not. You will know it. How come the power of the Holy Spirit coming upon your life and you are not aware of it? It is impossible. You will know it. Pray until. Ask until. Seek until. Knock until. For everyone who asks receives, everyone who seeks finds, and everyone who knocks it gets opened unto him. Because the task of world evangelization is mountainous, it is Herculean. It is neither by might nor by power, but by my Spirit. Who says? It was not the words of Zechariah. But by my Spirit says the Lord of hosts, the Lord of armies. We're talking about soldiers in God's kingdom. It's by my Spirit. I get energized and excited when I come over that passage. It's a huge mountain, don't worry. But it will become a plain because it is by his Spirit. And ask God for the gifts of the Holy Spirit to operate through you. You know, missionary work is a naked power encounter. In one of the villages in Orissa, when we cast out a demon from a tribal man, we removed the talisman from his left arm to open the talisman to find inside a small blade of a grass on which was written 666. We were thinking that we were the first civilized people walking into the tribal village. But before Christian missionaries went there, anti-Christian forces have already made inroads. The church is late, though not too late. So a holy anger should grip us when we go to these places. Because the devil for millennia has kept these people under illegal bondage. Why should any man be under the bondage of sin and shame than superstition after Christ has died for him on the cross? We are engaged in a warfare. It's no easy talk. It's not a cakewalk. And when we go there, we need to release them. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel of deliverance, to set the captive free. Tongue talking is not the purpose of Pentecost. Releasing people from every tongue and tribe, that is the real purpose of Pentecost. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are not a luxury, but they are a necessity. Ask God to manifest the gifts of the Spirit through you. Expect God to work. Lord, behold their threatening. Why do nations rage? Why do heathens make plans against you or anointed? Let signs and wonders be done through the hands of your servants. And when they prayed, the place where they had gathered together was shaken. We don't pray, so our places are taken. But they prayed, the place was shaken, and they spoke the word of God with boldness.
May the Lord give us that militant spirit. Why not? I deliberately choose that word, a militant spirit. Once upon a time, we were dead bones, dry bones. A little bit of rattling has come, and we stop with rattling. That's wrong. Rattling is not revival. Little bit of shaking up is not revival. Bone to bone coming together is not revival. That's not good enough. Flesh and sinews coming on that skeleton again is not revival. That is not enough. Standing as a militant army is also not enough. We should start marching on. We should start marching on. Which level have you stopped? Where have you stopped? Keep flowing in the modern day move of the Holy Spirit, which began with the last day, which began on the day of Pentecost. Let's flow with the Spirit. We have been sleeping too long. God is moving. And let's move on with Him. There's already a sound hearing on the mulberry tree. March on, brother, march on. March on, march on. Missionaries of Indian Evangelical Mission, march on, march on. The sound has been there for so long. Don't delay any longer. Don't linger on any longer. Don't limp between two opinions any longer. Go ahead and push. Eighthly, the eighth basic that we need to redefine is our strategy. Strategy is very important for military troops. What is our strategy? Our strategy is guidance. That is our strategy. Losing which, we lose everything. A battalion will have several troops. All troops will not have the same function. There is one particular job assigned to each troop. And they go according to the direction and according to the guidance. You know, I still remember what I spoke to you yesterday or day before. The reason for the successful itinerant missionary evangelistic ministry of Apostle Paul was he inquired of the Lord. And the Lord would wake him up in the night and tell him what he should do next morning. Lord, what will you have me to do? Make that prayer every morning. And make that prayer when you are not able to decide that way or this way. Ask for direction. You know, at the beginning of my ministerial career, I asked the Lord for one blessing, because whenever I have read the biographies of great men of God, they always will say, ask God for one thing very specific of all the other things. God asked Solomon for one thing, and he asked for wisdom, even in dream, even when he was asleep. So I was just preparing my mind to ask God for something. You know what came up to my mind? Lord, all the years of my life and ministry, I want one thing from you. I want your guidance. I want your direction. And I want to humbly acknowledge before God, before this huge gathering of God's saints and servants, that God has sumptuously given me guidance and direction, which wherever appropriate, I passed it on to my fellow leaders, and things have worked out well for the glory of God, and the kingdom has expanded. Because we are under orders. We are on HMS, His Majesty's Service. So He must tell us what we should do, and we should constantly be watching, waiting for HMV, His Master's voice. We should keep our ears trimmed and tuned to hear what God has to tell us. And don't ever try to cross tracks. Go in your direction. Don't cross tracks as P.T. Usha did and lost the medal. The last dash. She did very well, but she missed it in the last dash because she crossed the track. Now many times we do it. We cross the tracks. We are shifty. Now, there is a track that is set for you. That's what the Bible says, a race that is set for us. Track that is assigned to us. Go straight in the track. We have had many good past experiences. Thank God for them. But I always believe past experiences can be a guide, but they cannot become a guidance. Hope you understand. They can be a reference, but they cannot become a guidance. Depending upon past experiences sometimes misleads us. It's good to have lots of committees, a lot of discussion, but sometimes we may suffer from too much of committee meetings. There was a man who spent all his life in committee meetings, and then the sculptor made an epitaph for his tomb, and that man died, and they put it on that, you know, there was a spelling mistake. He said, "I committed to death." The fellow had put it as "committed to death." Now we in the mission context should be very, very careful. Good to have committees. Discussion is good, but direction is what is wanted. Sometimes you may be discussing. And what comes out, the child will be able to say, this must be the work of a committee. But somebody may come with a prophetic voice. I don't know whether you have learned to recognize prophetic voice. It may be a very insignificant person in your field. And he may just open up his mouth and speak a few words, and it will just open up the situation. Suddenly a fresh light will come into the situation, and things which otherwise were very unclear, whether the new Gentile believers should be circumcised or not. Now, what is wrong? After all, salvation is by faith in Christ, and nothing wrong to get circumcised as a medical treatment or a medical procedure to be on the safer side, etc. So big discussion was going on until the man stood up and he interpreted that Old Testament prophecy of Amos, which said, "I will restore the tabernacle of David." People were talking about circumcision, and the fellow was quoting a passage about tabernacle. See, that's what I call prophecy. The man could take the scriptures and explain it relevantly under the spirit unction for that situation. And you know what the Bible says? When James explained that scripture passage from book of Amos and said, "I will restore or rebuild the tabernacle of David," they all became quiet and they said, "We should not disturb Gentiles with what our forefathers could not even touch with their fingers." We need such input. So never ever despise. Just because a man has put in only 2 years or 5 years and you are 20 years. 20 years seniority is not necessarily a guarantee that your direction is going to be perfect. Generally, yes, but not always. So learn to respect the guidance and the light that comes from various ranks and files, various levels of missionaries. I know I am touching a very touchy subject, but that is the truth, we can't escape it. Let us learn to recognize God's work from wherever it comes. If we miss guidance in our ministry, I want to say something. If you miss guidance in ministry, there is no future for Indian Evangelical Mission, for any mission for that matter. The Lord doesn't guide us, where shall we go? Ninthly, the ninth basic that we need to redefine and emphasize, our protection. Our protection. As an army we march towards the enemy to fight him and punish him. Our protection, it is nothing but faith. Our protection is faith. Friends, as we target to save souls from his clutches, he is outrightly determined and dedicated and committed to destroy us. There are seven weapons. And which is the weapon that we need to take above all? Faith. Above all, taking the shield of faith. I don't know whether you understood it. Above all. Above all. Without faith, you cannot please God. And without faith, you cannot be a missionary. You cannot do missionary work. So above all, hold that faith. Because that is the one that will really give us protection.
And I want to send you with a word of encouragement when you get back to the field.
Let come what may, if God is for us, if God is for us, once again, if God is for us, who can be against us?
Sometimes, you know, I take that word and one word, I just take and keep it.
If God be for us, who can be against us?
If God is for us, who can be against us?
If God is for us, who can be against us? If God is for us, who can be against us?
I believe in the verbal inspiration of the scripture, and I take it like that. And I feed my inner man with it and get strengthened in my spiritual muscles. So take these promises and take them, eat them like that, bit by bit. God be for us, who can be against us? At the end of his great ministerial life, John Wesley said, the greatest of all is, God is with us. I just love that statement. The greatest of all is, God is with us. Friends, you are going to have lots of persecution. Things are going to turn much, much more difficult than all it has been over the past years. And this particular decade is going to see more martyrs than any time in church history. The signs are there. But we will be more than conquerors. Death or life or angels, this, that, nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in us.
People can separate your life from your body. The Bible does not say nobody can separate your life from the body. Don't misread it. People can separate your life and from your body, your spirit from your body. But nobody can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Even death cannot do it. So that means death can be there.
Sometimes we'll wonder. I was really struggling yesterday and day before.
After all, a retreat, a triannual conference of a reputable Indian missionary agency. A team of people were coming from Bangalore to take care of the children of those missionaries. What victim is it? What crime? They were coming to take care of the children so that the parents can attend to the session without any hindrance, easily. Of all the vans which fly from Bangalore, should this van meet with an accident? How many vans which go to Ayyappa Bakkar Hills, they go safe and return safe? Why could it happen? Stephen was a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit. When people shouted taunts at him, did all the angels go on furlough? Where were they? When everybody threw a stone, he could have got his right hand paralyzed. Or when that man pelted a stone, the stone could have got into a different direction.
Nothing happened. Hit. Everything hit.
Why?
We don't know. You ask why, God will ask why not. It can happen, but we are more than conquerors. You know what is that? Nothing can separate us from the love of Christ, from the love relationship that we have from our heavenly bridegroom. That will actually usher us into the physical immediate presence of our bridegroom. It doesn't separate us, but it fixes us together, close. Never ever forget, the blood of martyrs is the seed of the church. It's not just something to be framed and hung on our wall as a wall fix, but that's an encouragement for us. I don't know whether any time you pause to remember that in India, you know where we have the biggest church? It is in Madras. You know which church it is? The New Life Assemblies of God Church, as far as India is concerned, is the biggest church in this country. And where is it situated? According to the best available traditions, the place very close to the martyrdom of Apostle Thomas. It's not a coincidence, it's not just accidental. God has designed it to be that way.
Hallelujah!
I still remember what Rajaji used to say about the persecution of missionaries. You know what he said? Don't persecute Christians. They are bedbugs. They are bedbugs. You crush them, they only multiply. You have thousands and thousands of people praying for you here on earth when you go to missionary work, and there are thousands and thousands of angels awaiting you in case you have to meet a martyr's death to receive you. So be encouraged. There may be some apprehension and fear. I don't expect everybody to be naturally having that champion spirit. It's very difficult. Before the first stone falls on us, we will pester our general secretary for a transfer back to Tamil Nadu. It's not so easy, but be encouraged. There are people who are supporting you here and waiting to clap hands there the moment you are going to breathe last. And sometimes the Son of God, who is normally seated on the right hand of God the Father, will also stand up in honor of you to receive you, as in the case of Stephen. I see the Son of God standing. Not sitting, no, he's not standing to receive you. Be encouraged. And God bless you. Simply and lastly, our basic is the knowledge of our enemy. Our enemy, Satan. Satan is our enemy. This statement may look very obvious, nevertheless, we forget it many times. That is why we forget this important truth and we fight our fellow Christians and ministers. This, because we forget that Satan is our enemy, we start fighting with our own fellow brothers and sisters. There are seven oneness factors in Ephesians 4th chapter. Read it when you find time. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one hope, one Father, etc., etc. And if you permit me, I would like to add one more to it. Not in the Bible, but just for our interpretation. One enemy. One enemy. Our enemy is Satan. Your enemy is not your fellow worker. Your enemy is not Paul. Your enemy is not Barnabas. Your enemy is not John Mark. Your enemy is Satan. Don't fight within yourself. Don't kick self-fight doors. Come together. Fight the enemy. Never underestimate him. The Lord Jesus said, "No, I am with you always." First he said go, and then he said no. When you go, the no comes for you. Go, no, I am with you. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Shall we all stand up to read aloud our theme song of this conference? I believe that summarizes all that we meditated during these 3 days. Oh, help me, Jesus, to be diligent. Oh, help me, Savior, to myself present, approved unto God, a workman of faith, rightly dividing the word of truth. March on, march on, the trumpet call I hear. March on, march on, our Lord's coming is near. Oh, just like Moses, let me be faithful. In all your house, Lord, let me be truthful. I'll work for my Lord, praising always, safely abiding well in your arms. Oh, just like Joseph, let me be watchful. In all my ways, Lord, let me be careful. Let me not sin, Lord, and keep off from shame, jealously guarding my life from crime. Oh, just like David, let me be worthy, man after your heart, though mine is faulty. I bring souls to God,
from ends of the earth, sacrificing my life for the truth. March on, march on, the trumpet call I hear. March on, march on, our Lord's coming is near. Gracious Father, we thank you this morning for bringing us to the conclusion of these 3-day Bible readings. We pray, O God, that the lessons your Holy Spirit has implanted in our hearts will save our souls, strengthen our spirits, sanctify our inner man, and O God, send us forth again into the vineyard to gather the grapes and the grains and satisfy your eternal longing. We give you all glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray.